Hi class, it's Bill Berry continuing in a second video on our bakery project. We've already looked at the hierarchy and understood it. We made some sense of the flow of data from one function to another, the callee and caller business, and then we took that and started fleshing out our program by putting in what the parameters need to be, right? Those are the down arrows, what the returns need to be, those are the up arrows, and then once things are passed back to us, we need to store them on the caller side so that we can make use of them. Now, you don't always have to store them, but you do need to make use of them. So for the moment, let's just put them in variables so we know they're sitting there waiting for us. Now, at this point, we can start fleshing out the rest of what has to happen here, and it's very easy. We really don't have much to do. The display summary is going to actually be the hardest part. So now, let's just see what we need to do to deal with the sort of dot, dot, dots, the to-dos here. First of all, in our input order data, I need to return a pie count and a cake count, but I better determine those somehow, right? I better say pie count equals, and then I need to take an input and ask the user, how many pies do you want? How many pies in the order? All right, I do that, and then I want that to be an integer in order to be able to multiply it and things like that, so I need to take an integer of the result. Alright, that makes sense. And then instead of just pie count here, I'm going to do cake count, and I'm going to say how many cakes in the order. Right, so these are going to be very parallel. In fact, I'm going to line those up so that visually they're right there. And that's all I really have to do. Now, we do have a little bookmark in our head that says someday we need to learn how to not blow up when people type in strings. Well, yeah, that's for another day. We'll get there soon. But that's what order data needs to do. We said we need to return the pie count and the cake count. And then, of course, here we actually gather the pie count and the cake count. By returning them here, they get passed back from this call. They get stored in these two variables. Again, don't freak out that these are different names. It doesn't matter. This is a different function. It can name things a different way or the same way if it happened. Remember, you can have multiple people working on parts of projects and they don't have to have this sort of mindless naming that has to be perfect and dictated across the whole team. Each function is an independent element, so that's okay. So order data, that's really all it needs to do. To price the order, we know that that's complete, right? We find out we need to price the pies, and of course we said, oh, we need to pass the pie count, right? Because if you're going to determine the price of the pies, you need to know how many they ordered. Same thing here, right? We need to pass in the cake count. Again, you'll notice down here we expected a pie count and we expected a cake count, so we better pass those in, and this is what they are called here. And then it can add those up, and it can, say here's the total, this calculates the tax, the total, calls those functions, passes the right stuff, and returns all the data we said, which is stored right here to be passed along to display summary. Now, we have some very small things left to do, right? We need to actually figure out how to come up with the pie total, right? Again, we've already said what we want to return, so now it's just a matter of calculating it. Well, if you take the pie count and you multiply it by however much the pie is going to cost, which we said in the spec was $17.99, and then we return it, that's it, right? That's all we have to do. Same thing with cake total. We take the cake count and we multiply it by $24.99. That's what we were told in the spec, and then that's it. Now, it's one of the things that we don't like is to have magic numbers. You know that these things are going to change, and you know that you don't want to just have a number in there where people go, where did $17.99 come from? And if you find yourself having to do this, $79 is the price of a pie. Well, that kind of tells you that something's, you shouldn't have to put a description on a literal like that. So one of the things we might do is to just take this $17.99, come to the top of the program, and make a little section for constants. So I'm going to do this, and I'm going to say constants, and then I'm going to say pie price equals, and I'm going to say cake price equals. I'm going to make those two constants. They're not really constants, remember, but that's as close as we can get in Python. And then I'm going to mark those there, and I'm going to also sort of separate those here and say this is main. And then just because I can, I'm going to then say this is my input and this is my calculations. It's not always so simple, but in this case it's not too bad. Might as well, while we're in a bannering kind of mood, we might as well kind of do that. Okay, this is the output. Cool. Okay, so now we have our program starting to line up pretty well, and we've now taken and made a constant, or at least a variable, for pie price, and now I'm going to go use it down here. Right? So the idea is here that if that changes in the future, and if I look down at this, then I see, oh, cake price, it makes sense to multiply the cake count by the cake price. And if you see those uppercase names, you know, oh, that's going to be defined at the top as a constant or a variable. So now that's a little bit nicer, right? We've been a little bit better. We also will be a little bit nicer for us if we define what these things do. So it's traditional to put some sort of little banner that says inputs order data from the user, and etc. So I can go do that as I think of it, and this one's going to be price is the order. Sorry, I'm doing things in a funny order, but this is iterative program development. This is kind of how it goes. Prices the pies in an order. I'll copy that. I'll paste that here, and I'll prices the cakes in an order, etc. Let me just finish those real quick for us. Okay, so I put in all those little headers just because it occurred to me at that point that that was a good idea. So now let's continue. We're almost done with these calculation functions. How do I calculate a subtotal? Well, or a tax, rather. Well, tax is pretty easy. I would take a subtotal and multiply it by 0.095. Ah, well, here's another one of those constant-y kind of things. I might want to pull this up here and say tax rate equals, and then I put that number there, and then instead of using the hard-coded number, I'm simply going to use this. I like that much better. And then I return the tax. Now, one thing that we may need to do, we're not told in the spec, but it's something that you'll see pretty quickly, is that we need to make sure that the tax is rounded to an even number of dollars. The order can't be wrong, right? The order can't be off, but the tax certainly can be when it multiplies. So what we might want to do here is to do some rounding, where we just call the round function, and we do that multiplication, and then we round it to two digits, right? So that's an easier way to, that's a very easy way to round it to two, so that we'll always be guaranteed that when we print the thing out, the total, subtotal, and the tax always add up correctly, and we're not off by a penny, and you know, whatever, this is just necessary. And then, last but not least, to calculate the total, this one's kind of silly, but you know, we can take subtotal and add tax to it. Right? That's hardly worth it. Probably not worth a function to do that, but that's what's in the call hierarchy. Let's pretend that's right for the moment. So now we actually have a program that is pretty darn complete. Now, we haven't run it once, which is kind of a problem, but we don't really have any output, right? We don't have anything to do. So just for fun, let's just print something, number of pies. Let's just print some silly stuff. Number of pies equals, let me just print a couple little print statements really quickly. Okay, so I'm going to put some kind of dumb little print statements. Now, this is another thing to keep in mind. Anytime you do something like this and you go, wow, isn't there an easier way than going and typing a bunch of print statements and then I go take them out afterwards because I'm not really going to want them, I'm going to want something different? Well, yes, of course there is. We're going to learn to use the debugger, and the debugger would let us stop on, you know, put one line in here and stop and inspect all of our local variables so we could see the contents of all of these guys by just looking in our debugger. So that is a better deal, but for the moment we haven't looked at that, so you get the idea. Now, if we've done our homework correctly, let's see if we have. I have not run this program, so you'll be as surprised as I am at whether we get any good results out. So let us try and run it. I'll save it. I'll press F5. How many pies? Let's put this in the upper corner. How many pies? I want 5 pies and I want 6 cakes. All right, so you need to go in and see if we have done the right thing. So 5 times 17, 99, plus 6 times 24, 99. Is that indeed this pie price? Is this the cake price? We didn't expect that, right, to be off by by that, but that's floating point number. That's the nature. Here's a subtotal. Here's a tax. So you would want to go and actually verify this independently. Do it in Excel. Do it by hand. Verify that you've got good data here. And in fact, we might want to have some tests on the individual functions. We haven't gotten into this quite yet, but it would be very cool if we actually had some programmatic tests where we tested our own functions and had our own independent verification that we were doing the right stuff in all of these. But I think it's actually looking pretty darn good. I think we've I think we've done a reasonably good job And that matches what I have in some separate work, so I think that's kind of right. So that is darn good. We've actually done all of the upper part of the program. We have it all working. It's labeled pretty nicely. It's got the constants here. It's really quite looking quite good. Now, you know, do I need comments on these? Do I need any more comments than what I have? I don't think so. Because if the variable names are good and the function names are good, you can read it just like this. I set the pi total by calling price the pies, and I tell it how many pies I have. So if you can read the code that easily, don't comment on it, right? The comments are just going to be either redundant or they're going to look stupid because they say the obvious. Like, calculate the tax on the subtotal. Well, of course, that's what this line says. So how can you comment on it and add more value? So the program's looking really good, and it's actually, you know, doing everything right. It just doesn't have a pretty output. And remember, we said we want it to look something more like this when we're done. So that's another challenge, but we're going to take that up in a third video. Now that we have all the calls working, the data is being passed back and forth, go back and think about what I said about these names. As long as they are internally consistent in a function, you don't have to be just a slave to the dumb naming that's everywhere else in the program. You're welcome to use the same variable names if it makes you happy, but you certainly don't have to because they are independent. Every function is independent. So go back and look at that, and then we will in the next video tackle this little output part where we make the report pretty, which is another whole interesting challenge. So thanks for watching this video, and continue on to the third for the output.